co-creators and fellow freedom fighters have asked me to do the acknowledgement, but I'm having them to learn how to do this because everywhere we go here on the land, we should acknowledge that we are on land that belongs to the tribe of the Duwamish, who have not been recognized yet by the federal government, and that we should continue the efforts to make that happen. And so I want to also take that moment and give honor and acknowledgement that we are on Duwamish land. I am of Cherokee background, and I'd like to chat with y'all about that at some other time. But I say this in terms of creating tension and moral pressure, because there are a lot more Black Indians in the nation, and a lot of them are disenfranchised because of the quantum laws, and we'll have that conversation on another day and time. So to begin, our co-facilitators said that we should start with a quote. This is a letter, and the quote from Dr. King's letter from Birmingham Jail. First, I must confess that over the past few years, I have been gravely disappointed with the white moderate. I have almost reached the regrettable conclusion that the Negro's great stumbling block in his stride toward freedom is not the White Citizens Council or the Ku Klux Klaner, but the white moderate, who is more devoted to order than to justice, who prefers a negative peace, which is the absence of tension, to a positive peace, which is the presence of justice, who constantly says, I agree with you in the goal you seek, but I cannot agree with you in your methods of direct action, who paternalistically says and believes he can set the timetable for another man's freedom, for another woman's freedom, for another person's freedom, who lives by a mythical concept of time, and who constantly advises the Negro to wait for a more convenient season. So that is why we are here. We want to talk about the different seasons where we across the globe have made it inconvenient for others. Satyagraha, nonviolent direct action. A purpose of our talk is to share knowledge and tactics of Satyagraha, which is popularly known as nonviolent direct action. Now, Satyagraha is Sanskrit and Hindu for holding on to truth. And to me, that's really deep because you might not be able to hold on to truth with violent means, but with nonviolent action, that is the truth. So when you hold on to the truth, what else can you hold on to? And Satyagraha has its origins in Mohandas Gandhi, who was trained as an attorney and was very active in setting up creative tension in South Africa for those who were called colored. You know, there was a caste system. So those who were colored, who were of Indian background, were not able to collectively bargain, were not able to have certain, what they considered third class citizens. He moved on from South Africa to India to protest the British colonialism. And others felt that this concept really does make sense in the movements that they're part of. And so Sheena's going to speak to you not only about how King has taken this on into his own concept, but how it's being used in other parts of the world.
So here's a quote from Dr. Martin Luther King. World peace through nonviolent means is neither absurd nor unattainable. All of the methods have failed. Thus, we must begin anew. Nonviolence is a good starting point. Those of us who believe in this method can be voices of reason, sanity, and understanding amid the voices of violence, hatred, and emotion. We can very well set a mood of peace out of which a system of peace can be built. So there are six principles of non-direct violent action.
Non-violent
direct action, excuse me. So the first is information gathering. Second is education. Third is personal commitment. And fourth is discussion and negotiation. Fifth is direct action, which we will be honing in on for today's event. And sixth is reconciliation.
All right, but I like to stand when I present because I'm really fidgety, so I'm going to go ahead and stand if that's okay with everyone. So a couple of the goals are nonviolent direct action. When you talk about nonviolent direct action, a lot of people say, you know, what's the point? Why are you getting people out in the street marching? Why are people engaging in some of the tactics that we engage in when we use nonviolent direct action? And so I'm also going to read a quote from Dr. Reverend Martin Luther King from his letters from the Birmingham jail, where he says that nonviolent direct action seeks to create such a crisis and foster such a tension, that a community which has constantly refused to negotiate is forced to confront the issue. It seeks so to dramatize the issue so that it can no longer be ignored. And so when we talk about creating tension, Dr. King also was very vocal about the fact that nonviolent direct action in itself does not create tension. What nonviolent direct action does is it brings underlying tension to the surface, which is very, very important. And so that's one of the things that you see a lot of times today with like the Black Lives Matter movement in particular. So Black Lives Matter is not creating tension in our communities. These are communities that are already experiencing tension. But this tension is oftentimes glossed over or whitewashed. And so by going out and marching and protesting and doing the things that Black Lives Matter does, it's really kind of forcing communities and our society to take a look at some of these tensions. Another thing that direct action seeks to do is provide moral pressure. So if you look at the United States Civil Rights Movement, one of the things that happened that really, really galvanized support for the Civil Rights Movement was that people in the North, particularly white people in the North, the racism being experienced by folks in the South was largely a problem in the South. And so what happened was when you started to see things like the Alabama, the bus boycotts, and then all of a sudden there were televised images of nonviolent protesters being sprayed with water hoses and being attacked by dogs. And these were children, these were students. What it really did was created a moral crisis, right, for folks in the North, predominantly white folks, to say, hey, we can't allow this stuff to be happening. This can't be real. So that's one of the primary goals of nonviolent direct action, is to create a moral crisis for folks that may not be directly affected by the oppression that's taking place. So some of the tactics of NDDA. Some of the tactics of NDDA you'll see sit-ins. Boycotts are oftentimes very popular with nonviolent direct action. Economic disruptions. So I know like we're talking about the Dakota Access Pipeline right now. So divestment from Wells Fargo, things like that. Legislative disruptions. So anything that works towards pressuring or causing pressure towards legislators on local, state, federal levels. And then teach-ins. COSI was born out of Occupy teach-ins. Teach-ins are very important. So community education is a huge, huge piece to nonviolent direct action.
So we're going to share some personal stories before we get into Chile and South Africa. So these, if you just want to take a look at these are kind of some things that we've all, us three, been involved in. We're going to speak upon a few. So I'm going to go first. I identify as a queer Japanese and Chinese American. And I wanted to talk to you guys about the educational component of nonviolent direct action. So this past summer, I was honored to visit the incarceration camps where my grandparents and great-grandparents were. So this is after Pearl Harbor during World War II.
Where they were
incarcerated. So the reason why I used incarceration versus internment, which it was formerly known as, is because internment means that they were just staying there. Incarcerated means they were forced. So they were staying out in the middle of nowhere in barracks, where there were about 110,000 to 120,000 people taken from the communities their homes, their schools, and businesses, and placed here. So I have been on this pilgrimage a few times, but this year was much different. Instead of just talking about the Japanese-American experience during World War II, we brought it to a more relevant, through a more relevant lens. And so what we did is we did some workshops where we spoke, or where we had our guest speaker, Namir Islam, joining us to do some digging. So we kind of did some intersectionality between past history and what current events are happening right now, because there are some trends happening of what has happened to people in my history and people up here now. And so I'm just going to share with you a quick bio of Namir for all of you. So she's a lawyer and a graphic designer. She is the co-founder and executive director of the Muslim Anti-Racism Collaborative, which is a faith-based human rights education organization focusing on racial justice. Namir has practiced in poverty law, providing legal services to low-income individuals in Flint, Michigan, and interned in international criminal law for the United Nations Her experience in anti-racism work includes researching the UN Declaration of Human Rights education and training. Namir resides in the Metro Detroit area and is alumna of the University of Michigan, Ann Arbor, and the Michigan State University College of Law. So, let's see. So the idea was to create some tension and to bring a whole new aspect to what I've done multiple years, to try to just spark different conversations and how two communities can come together and work together to support one another.
Okay, and so a few of the movements that I personally have been involved with during nonviolent direct action is I kind of got to my feet when I got started with the LGBTQI movement, repeal of Don't Ask, Don't Tell, the ending of the Defense of Marriage Act, and then the Employment Non-Discrimination Act. I've also recently took a trip out to Cannonball, North Dakota, and spent some time with the Standing Rock Sioux Tribe in North Dakota in opposition to the Dakota Access Pipeline. And I also spent 2 weeks in Ferguson, Missouri in August of 2014 after Mike Brown was killed protesting with the community there. And so what wanted to do is show a quick, maybe 5 minute clip.
No less than 5 minutes.
Okay.
Now can you hear us?
So.
Hi, everybody. My name is Sean. Do you know how to refer to yourself? I'm asking you to leave the free office.
Let's go, folks. Get an answer on an up and down vote on the Employment Non-Discrimination Act.
That's right.
We've been locked out the American dream and locked out of our Speaker of the House's office. So yeah, so that was an example of what we would call nonviolent direct action. No violence was used on our part during that specific action. And again, if you look back at what we talked about, some of the goals were to create tension. That was obviously creating tension with legislative bodies in the United States of America. And we also were trying to speak to the moral conscience of folks. I mean, so when you look at imagery like that, you see people being arrested, they're being drug out of their representative's office simply for trying to speak with representatives, things like that. It kind of creates a moral crisis for folks when we talk about we have a representative government, we have a representative democracy, they won't even meet with us, they're having us drug out and arrested. So that's a little bit of my personal experience with nonviolent direct action, and I will pass it off to Dr. Hunt.
If y'all want to ask questions and you can, please let us know. So I've been involved with a lot of different movements. Growing up in the segregated South, and there's still a railroad track that separates white and black people from my 6,000 person town. It's a very real, reminder of that violence can be used, but when violence is used and you're like 1% of the population, you might not be around and like continue to fight. One of the first times I really got to spend deep work in nonviolent direct action was during the 80s when we had refugees from El Salvador and Nicaragua in this country, and I was in California. And our federal government was not willing to call these people refugees. They wanted to call them, illegal. Because of our policies in Central America, these people had to flee. So I was part of what was called the Sanctuary Movement, First Sanctuary Movement, where churches just said, well, we're going to create safe space. And these are the places where people are going to be able to live, work, and be protected. And as nonviolent direct action, the sanctuaries have historically been a place where if you were able to go there, the state would stay outside of the church. And so people were actually calling their houses sanctuary because they said, if I'm part of the church, then it's not just the church that's a sanctuary. It's like, If you were living in your house, you would say, my house is an extension of this church, and my house is a sanctuary too. So we're able to take care of lots of people. I could talk to you about other activities, but I think that one I wanted to speak to y'all about, because right now, when it comes to dreamers and folks who are unauthorized, seen document those, we're trying to figure out ways in which we can do this again. Because it's going to have to be the general, the people. I don't think the state is going to be able to do what it needs to be. What needs to be done. Even before we moved into this peaceful transfer of power, I always felt that we need to have a new sanctuary. So I wanted to also give y'all some history and lessons. Well, another reason for the sanctuary movement has put moral pressure on the state. And it also created tension, revealed the tensions within communities. So I want to speak to you about the No campaign. I don't know if y'all are familiar with Chile and Pinochet. Are y'all familiar? No, you know he was a dictator. But you might not know how he got taken care of. When we use the word dictator, he rose to power in a coup d'etat, I think it was 1973, and lots of people were disappeared. Lots of people were tortured, lots of people were raped, lots of people were violated, in mind and spirit. And it was hard to even speak about what could be done. So in what is called a plebiscite, which is essentially an up and down vote, a yes-no vote, that you would support whoever is the candidate rather than reject the candidate. No would be a rejection. Pinochet decided that we would allow for a plebiscite. And individuals all over the country, like what we find here with the Women's March, it was a slow but on the ground movement to say, why don't we use the institutional structure to, as a way of using nonviolent direct action, to put moral pressure and to make this change where it could be irrefutable. So instead of just marching, we're using the levers of institutions. So the plebiscite, which Commission really didn't believe anybody was going to vote no, the no was to mean, no, we reject Pinochet's rule. 56%, folks, 56% of the public were able to vote. It wasn't an easy thing to do to vote. I mean, to come out would mean that if they didn't win, then lots more people were going to be disappeared. So again, creative tension, more pressure. So, let's see, is there anything else we want to speak to you about that? I think that we might be needed to do this ourselves, figure out institution, because I'm a political scientist. Actually, I'm turning in my union card because, not my teacher's union, but political science, they all got this shit wrong. They got it wrong. Now, I am an international political scholar. I study migration, but none of the political scientists got it. And so, actually, I am tearing up my card and sending it to our association because it doesn't allow for the kind of, studies that we want to do. What we want to do gets marginalized because everybody's studying electoral politics. They're studying systems, but they're not studying people. And then they didn't get it right. So yes, I'm sorry, I just had to do that small rant because we're talking about institutional structure. We need to pay attention to in what ways can we occupy certain institutional structures. And that's another way of engaging in nonviolent direct action. I've seen you all do it. Our young people in this room, y'all keep it down with the occupying and coming into institutional structures. So, do we want to play a little bit of that?
This is just a really quick clip on the day of the plebiscite in Chile in 1988 that I found. It's only about a minute and a half long, so I think that we have time. And this is just speaking with some of the opposition. And what some of their fears were about the plebiscite at the time. So, should you know if you could just click play really quick?
Isabella, what are you expecting tomorrow?
We are very worried because we have heard rumors. We have heard the State Department calling the Chilean ambassador in Washington, telling him that they have knowledge that they are trying to do something to stop the plebiscite and that they should do it. Now, when the State Department calls the Chilean ambassador in Washington, it's because he knows something serious. He doesn't call because of a rumor. So I don't know what the government is planning to do tomorrow. What I know is the Chilean people has already given their vote, and their vote is no to Pinochet, yes to democracy.
Well, I think that the feeling of everybody today is that there is an overwhelming majority of people who will vote no. Now, the question is whether the government and the army will accept that no. I feel this uncertainty from everybody and the fear that what is going to happen after tomorrow.
Bueno, para mañana esperamos en primer lugar un triunfo contundente de la opción del no, de las fuerzas democráticas de este país. Esperamos reacciones del régimen de último momento que pudiesen intentar alterar los resultados del plebiscito. Es una posibilidad que ha estado siempre presente, pero tenemos los acuerdos en la oposición para enfrentar también esa posibilidad.
Endorse what I say. It's me talking, and I speak from being a defensive strategic studies scholar. I have experience in this. So one of the ways in which one shows legitimacy is to use the trappings, the ceremonial trappings of peaceful transfer of power, that then allows for you to engage in. Well, that's why I'm calling what we're doing now, not now, but now, in the nation of peaceful transfer of power. I don't know if I would call it an inauguration, but at least. But that doesn't mean we're not having direct action.
Yes. So I was there for the plebiscite, and the plebiscite comes about after about 10 years yes. worth of huge social movements, not only internally, but huge solidarity movement internationally. And that really made, turned the tides in Chile. There was no way Pinochet was going to do that unless it was both incredible international pressure, I mean, and huge international pressure, because he exiled about 2 million people, right? And so those exiles all went to Europe and they organized. They went to Europe and they went to Latin America and they went all over and they organized solidarity movements. And in many ways, so many of us really learned about solidarity and how what international solidarity looked like because of the Chilean movement. And that pressure was so huge that he knew that he needed to do something. It was 90% of the people out in the streets at some point, San Santiago. And so he realized very quickly, either do this to, you know, and of course we always knew that, most of us imagined that he wasn't going to let go of power. But the pressure from outside, and that's why I think for us, same kind of lesson, that folks from Europe and other places around the world who are looking at our peaceful transition, like how you're doing, you know, are gonna, they will also provide pressure, and yes. we need to really make those ties, those international ties, because that's actually how it happens.
One, to piggyback on this, we need to be paying attention to Brexit too. We need to be adding more pressure to Great Britain, which, step in the up, I don't want to call them Great Britain, but I guess I have to because it's an official name, right?
Yeah.
Okay. England, which created a xenophobic, Islamophobic, hostile space. And when I saw this, I was in Havana in the summer, and I said, you know what? Trump's going to win because England has taken that step to have it. Are y'all familiar with Brexit? So we, as communities, need to be putting pressure on England and on the EU about Brexit so that we can get that same solidarity here. So not same solidarity, but the solidarity from the international community that we're all looking. We're all looking. Thank you. This is why we love co-manifesting. That's why we love co-manifesting.
Two things come to my mind, when you talk about the Chilean Brexit. The first one, in context of America, you know, with very bad voter suppression laws and, you know, even who gets to be on ballot, you know, that is like a limitation. And, you know, the second thing that comes to my mind is the recall vote for Scott Walker in Wisconsin in 2011, which, you know, which failed, you know, even though it was put out to people to vote. So how can we use, you know, the methods that you're talking about to, you know, make those things, make the institution of democracy and voting work in our favor, you know, because, you know, it can fail as well, right?
Yes, it can. I don't think that's going to be an easy answer to that because as a president, republic, not a democracy, meaning that you have state law, you have city laws, you have federal laws that either constrain either directly or indirectly enfranchisement. So that, for example, in one state, if you are anyway, been caught up in the system, you don't have the right to vote for the rest of your life. That's different from other states where you could have been caught up in the system in some way, and that's not what's a challenge. It could be that you have lien taxes on your property. So we have to figure out in our specific spaces, what can we do that's direct, not direct, but explicit and then not well seen that are encroachment on an enfranchisement. I know we have a person here who is actually involved with, Craig, you want to talk about the particular project you're working on right now? And I'm not glossing over that, but I think truly we need to figure out who is not able to vote and why in our very local spaces and do a long-term work on that. It could be 5 years, it could be a 10-year process. It should actually be a long-term solidarity project that people work with. When I use the word project, I'm using it in the socialist sense that this is something we do, and so if I die tomorrow, you continue with this. That's the first thing. That's the very first thing.
And then somebody has to be vigilant to make sure that they're not changed because we turned our head to do something else. Craig, you want to talk about this project that you're working on?
Well, okay. So I'm working on a project that's not directly related to nonviolence, but it is in a way. The Washington State Constitution is the worst constitution in the United States in terms of police, right, and police violence, okay? So what happens right now, for example, in the last 10 years in Washington State, 250 people have been killed by cops, right? You know how many cops have been prosecuted? One, right? And why is that? Because there's a law that says as long as a policeman acted with good faith, right, and without malice, he can't be prosecuted, right? And this law was actually passed during when crack became a serious problem in the 80s, right? So I'm working with a lot of people in the community here, and one of the tactics that we will use if it becomes necessary in terms of either supporting an initiative or legislative choices will be direct action, nonviolent direct action. That's not exactly, you know, related to what I'm doing, but can I just make a side note that you made about the voting stuff?
Yes.
Well, one thing that's really important to remember is that, you know, there are massive efforts going on, particularly in the South right now and other states, to try to disenfranchise people, right, by changing the laws. And all of those laws have their origins in post-Civil War and racism, right? Because what happened is after the Civil War, black people were empowered throughout the South, right? And when Reconstruction was overthrown, they had to figure out ways to keep people from not voting, and one of the ways they did that was through the prison system and chain gangs and incarceration, and it was sort of basically like, hey, you know what, we're going to put all these folks in prison if they do things like walk on a road without a pass. Did you know that? It was just like South Africa, right? So those kinds of things happened, and people step forward. And what's happened in the South right now is the Voting Rights Act, right, got rid of all of that stuff, but because we have semi-fascists on the Supreme Court in the legal system, they overturned that rule now, and states throughout the South, right, are putting up all kinds of barriers. Now, you gotta have 3 IDs when you come to register to vote and all this kind of stuff. And what we're gonna see is there's gonna be massive civil disobedience in various parts of the South and even in the North around this, okay? How many people are getting disenfranchised right now? Enough that would have made a difference in the election that just happened, okay? That's exactly what's going on. And so we have this wonderful, wonderful tool. And I think we should keep in mind that it is a tool only, because there might be some point when violence actually becomes necessary, but that's on very, very rare occasion. Can I just tell you one occasion?
Maybe not. I think that we have a second part to his question.
Okay.
I don't want to be disrespectful.
No, that's fine. You know, we can wait after the presentation, whatever.
I also did just want to point out really quick, if I could, just speaking about Scott Walker and the recall vote. Even though perhaps we didn't get the outcome that we wanted in the recall, but the only reason that vote even was able to take place was because of the huge amount of nonviolent direct action that was taking place. People were literally, hundreds and hundreds of people were camping out in the state house in Wisconsin. And there were mass arrests, and I mean standoffs with the police, and you know, eventually they, you know, bowed to that, even though perhaps the result wasn't what we wanted. At least we were heard to the point that we forced the government's hand to do something about it.
And we heard each other, which is, you can't lock us all up and you can't shoot all of us at the same time. You just can't do that. You can try, but we're such a mediated world, somebody's gonna see. I also was involved in WTO. I'm still on my age. I should ask all of these women. because it's not history for me. It was exciting as a young person to see folks who were being disappeared saying, you know what, hell's to no, it's time. Well, I might be the one disappeared today, but you can't disappear all of us through this institutional process. With WTO, where we came, it was not nonviolent direct action. Folks came out to do their party. But what those who were involved with nonviolent direct action and those who were interested in violent action, it was hard for them to talk to each other. But I think we ought to be able to talk to each other because, as you said, this is a tool. And you can have shock troops. You can have shock troops. Can I leave it at that? But it should be for the long term. And I don't mean that shock troops have to go and kill folk. I think that sometimes, shall we talk about what happened with the miners' strike in South Africa? Let's do that.
So,
that would be an example.
So I'm going to talk briefly. So South Africa, we could talk about opposition in South Africa, you know, dating back since the inception of South Africa. And I'm not to gloss it over. I'm not going to speak about South African apartheid. We could spend hours and hours and hours and hours and days in here. So one of the things that I did want to speak about when we talk about nonviolent direct action was a really famous miners' strike that took place in 2012. And in 2012, the Americana miners' strike took place, and so I don't know why I keep going backwards. So, just to give a little bit of background, the Americana miners' strike. The mines in Americana were owned by a foreign corporation called Longmen, and the National Union of Mine Workers went on strike in August of 2012 to demand higher wages. And if you remember, one of the goals and tactics that we discussed about nonviolent direct action was economic disruption. These are platinum mines. That's a lot of money that these corporations are losing out on every day that these folks are in the mines. And this was a huge, huge strike. Thousands and thousands and thousands of people occupied the Longmen mines. And so scabs weren't getting in. No platinum was being produced. They wanted a very quick and speedy resolution to this. But they didn't want to pay the folks any money. So they wanted them to get back in the mines, they wanted them to work, but they wanted to do that without having to pay them any more money. And so what they did is they used a tactic the state will often use, which is force. And so for several days, they tried to disperse the miners. The miners continued to occupy this space. I'm going to just show a really, really brief clip. It's maybe just a minute or so.
What Sean has not spoke to you about is that he is in solidarity with a lot of union folk all over the continent in the world, and some of his colleagues are South African union folk.
Oh,
doing
just doing
equal. So I just want to show my little Hassan in the bedroom if I can. So I just want to show you this brief speech.
Thank you.
So later on that afternoon that that speech was given... So later on that afternoon that that speech was given, which was August, I believe, the 16th, 2012, that gentleman led a march to the entrance of the Longmen Mine as he was leading the march. South African police opened fire on peaceful demonstrators, shot 112 of them, and killed 34 mine workers. And so I wanted to bring that to the forefront, just so everybody kind of has the understanding that when we engage in nonviolent direct action, there's always the risk that the state is going to do what the state does and use violence against us. And so when people historically have engaged in this type of tactic to effect change, they do so knowing that they may have to give their lives. And so the strike continued for about another week. Longmen Corporation buckled after huge, huge national and international outcry after the murder of all of those miners, and their contract negotiations were met, and so the wages that they were fighting for were granted to them, as well as some other rights. It just unfortunately cost 34 of the strikers their lives. So I wanted to bring that into this space.
So we have some resources, folks, and we can make this available for people. The King Center has a lot of information about nonviolent direct action. Can you, could you click the second one, the global nonviolent? The first one, I guess, the King Center, just so folks know what it looks like. I would take a look at it. It really has a lot of wonderful resources. Let's go to the second one, which is the... the Nonviolent Direct Action Database. You want me to do it? All kinds of resources so we can learn from others, both in the past as well as what's going on globally. And then the King Papers over at Stanford University. Not quite sure if we don't need to say much more. We want to open it up so that folks won't have to be rushing out. This is 10 to 1 and y'all have to get to class. Is there anything that we can answer for? Any questions?
Yeah, I mean, did the guy look, or was he one of the people that died?
I was a little confused. I thought he was asking them to call off their strike so it will let them flow and you can just keep getting paid.
He was calling for no retaliation. That's still a place to have a conversation. I think we ought to have a conversation at some time about what's the difference between protection of self and family and violent action. I really think we ought to have a conversation.
So what had happened a little bit previously to that is there had been an altercation between security forces and protesters. A couple of protesters and a couple of police officers had been killed a couple of days before. And so what he was urging them, because he said the life of the black person is so cheap, was to not engage them in violence because they would just kill all of them and find other people to come work the mines for salaries that they couldn't live on. And so he was encouraging them to continue the strike, but to not engage in that type of violence any longer.
All right, then a good question would be, when do you start getting about it? Because I've been marching before down in the south, I'm from Florida, and sometimes it gets really hectic down there. And I've seen people get beaten by the police and whatnot, and I, like, sometimes we outnumber, we outnumber them, and we're just watching, right? And well, who am I going to tell if he starts stopping?
I really would like for us to have a conversation, like an hour long, more than an hour, about this, because this is the kind of, and we do need to know how to parse that out for ourselves. Yes.
So I just saw this article this morning on The Intercept, which is one of Jeremy Scahill's publications, and he talked about there currently there are 5 bills on state floors that is criminalizing peaceful protests.
Yes, yes.
And so in response to this conversation, and I love how you using this as one method, you know, because a lot of times the narrative is this is the only method, the nonviolent struggle, and everybody, we, you know, get pushed Mahatma Gandhi's strategy
down
our throats.
Well, that's why I call him instead of Mahatma.
What's that?
That's why I call him by his name.
Mahatma Gandhi.
No, Mohandas.
Mohandas, sorry.
Yeah, we'll call him by his name rather than, and then not to not give him honor, but to not, to privilege one way of doing something as opposed to another without interrogating all ways of doing it. So we should have more conversations about this notion of criminalized, that's not new. Y'all don't act new, we know.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? We used to call it a Brownie Convention. If you had just two or more brown folks somewhere, folks would think it was a Brownie Convention, and they say it was against the law for you to like be on at an interception. Not intercepting, at a street corner.
So one of those states is North Dakota.
One of those states
is
Washington.
I wonder how they don't get three people.
Washington has a
can we do that sometime? Where's Kimberly? Can we do that sometime?
Yes.
We need to have that kind of conversation because it's relevant for us to know. Then we can make the kinds of decisions that we need to make. When I used to work shock troops, I shouldn't use it because I'm contextualizing it from what was in the Second World War. But one is, can you put on Fela Kuti? Put on International Chief. One nonviolent direct action is use music at the street level. And it's also a way of, just go into YouTube. Can we do it? Can we put that on there?
Is it Shanae as a folk singer during the conversation? She was brought up during one of the meetings that we had. And she was very pivotal in advocating for indigenous rights and the people saying that.
Let's do be some no nation.
I see.
I don't know if y'all know anything about the Fela Kuti, and if you don't, run, don't walk, forget his music. This man challenged the state every single day by the way he lived his life and his music. So this one is Beast of No Nation. There's International Chief where he's talking about how his country has been raped by the powers in that country. And the only way you can do anything about it is to speak about it. So, and he was one of the best looking men, live or dead, and he used that to his good authority. He did. He used it to his good authority, right? So people had to pay attention to him. I had one of us to start with. This is some fail, but this is another tactic, which is if you can make your music and get your music to other places, you can and put more pressure on places, along with another tactic. So you don't have to be marching, but also be in a house where that music is, you could be arrested. I mean, anytime. We don't want to keep y'all any longer than we need to because I know y'all are going to have to leave.
Do you have a question, sir, though?
About the difference between using violence to defend and using violence for attention. So that's, to me, that's a very clear cut difference. It's not that this is a cookbook recipe, it's not how really successful. But whatever you do, violent or nonviolent defense needs to stop a future hurt that you think is going to happen to somebody, yourself or somebody else. You don't use more action, more violence, more non-violence, more ill than necessary. Stop it, and you're willing to call off the fact that you don't. Using violence for its own sake, because you like to, is prudent. Using it because you feel hurt is rage over there. And that's a natural biological reaction, but it doesn't bring revolution.
Folks, y'all might have read our sister, elder sister, Toni Morrison, her book, Mercy. Have y'all read that? Y'all know that the action in Mercy, where a woman of African descent and in enslavement made the deliberate choice to take the life of her children. Now, what we understand about privileging the notion of motherhood and the sanctity of motherhood and that relationship between mother and child, she made a very deliberate act that still needs to be problematized because some of us say, how can anybody ever do that?
But if you are in a space of saying, well, my child will be violated, and my child's child will be violated, and my child's child's child will be violated, this act that someone else would call violence is a non-violent direct act that she took. It was a mercy that she was, I didn't even tell where I said that.
Because you know that in Nazi camps, that kind of thing. Mackenzie and Lee.
I did not know that. Yeah. So we ought to sit down and problematize this notion in interrogate what means.
Everybody, please join me in thanking our three fantastic presenters. All right, so as you heard, there'll be a future conversation that's going to happen.
Yes.
So I hope you all are able to join us for that. But next week, we're actually having our COSI on Sanctuary Cities. We'll have two representatives from El Comité who will be here to talk about the history, why they're so necessary, and how you can get involved.
Yes.
So if you have questions about that, come talk to me. If you have a session that you'd like to lead, come talk to me again. Thank you again, and thank you to our three presenters.
Yes, thank you. Thank y'all for being here. We really appreciate it. Y'all coming in and co-manifesting with us about this conversation. I really appreciate it.
Thank you.